Friday, and welcome to Collider Movie Talk for movie fans. I'm your host, Sinead DeVries, and this is a daily show where we bring you the latest news from the world of movies, plus some insight into what it all means. Joining me this morning is Dennis Zen.
Hello, everyone, and welcome back to another brand new episode of Collider Movie Talk. It's Friday. We got a lot of news to cover. I just want to remind you that we have that new Roku and Apple TV app for Collider Video. So check that out. Look, search there. You can download it. It has all of our videos there.
Awesome. Also here is John Rocha.
Should be the Rocha app, don't you think? The Rocha app works better? I don't know. It's just my opinion. The world is coming undone. Yes, I am here. I'm so excited to talk about so much, especially Rogue One, and then eventually, you know what's happening today. The Schmodown!
Also here is Kristian Harloff.
This guy loves banging on the table. It's going to be a very exciting day today. Yes, the electricity is in the air. Definitely the most anticipated rematch in Schmodown history. This character and the Mance Man. Yeah, we'll talk about it in a little bit.
All right, what's up first?
All right, Disney and Lucasfilm finally release a second full-length trailer for Rogue One, A Star Wars Story. The two-minute-long trailer gave us a ton of more footage, focusing in on the story centered around Felicity Jones' Jyn Erso character. But maybe the biggest reveal Star Wars fans were hoping for was the long-overdue reveal of Darth Vader, who was finally revealed at the very end with a short glimpse of him breathing in front of a monitor. Rogue One, A Star Wars Story opens on December 16th and stars Felicity Jones, Diego Luna, Ben Mendelsohn, Donnie Yen, Jian Wen, Mads Mikkelsen, Alan Tudyk, Riz Ahmed, and Forrest Whitaker. Dennis, your thoughts on the new trailer for Rogue One?
Well, first off, I want to mention that we have a trailer review and reaction up on the channel. You can check that out now, or you can check it out after Movie Talk. We shot that last night. That was a bit hectic, though. Like, we thought it was going to maybe come out at 6 p.m., 7 p.m., and it actually came out, what, like 7:45
really weird,
or
yeah.
Something like that. And that was when you were actually doing the your Schmozno live show.
Yep.
And I literally, we had everything set up in the other room and I was there waiting for you guys. And then you guys watched it on Schmoz, ran over and then shot our review and reaction and then ran back and hopped on air.
Yeah.
So a lot of craziness going around with that. But I really liked the trailer. I liked it because it gave what I needed, which was not too much. It didn't spoil anything for me, but it gave me all enough in there where you got to see a lot of cool visuals. It was shot on the Alexa 65, which is the same camera the Revenant was shot on. It just looked beautiful and gorgeous, and just some of the shots in there, like the bazooka aimed at the AT-AT. You had the TIE fighter rising with Jyn Erso walking, well, like actually hobbling with a gun in her hand. Kind of reminded me of the end of season 2 of Rebels with Darth Vader.
Yeah.
There's just so many cool things that the robot that like HK-47 in Knights of the World Republic.
Yeah.
Rocha, what did you think about this trailer?
I lost my mind. I was so happy with the trailer because I've been waiting for something that would reaffirm the fact that they were going to stay on the path of something gritty, something real dirty, something not like typical Star Wars that we'd seen before. And so because of all the rewrites and all the news, and even a week before where Hollywood Reporter had that article about Tony Gilroy coming in, like there was all kinds of worry about it. And I think this trailer did exactly what it was supposed to do, was to get it back on course, get you excited, get you to see that it's going to be that kind of film. And also, you're right, Dennis, really highlighted some of the characters and the storylines that we're going to be pursuing. It's basically getting the gang back together. It might be a better version of Suicide Squad, that's for sure, where you're getting these kind of rogue elements together to battle this huge, imminent evil thing. And yes, seeing Vader was great. Those of us who've been following this knew it was going to happen at some point, so it wasn't that big of a surprise. But I think for other people who, like, sometimes we forget we're so knee-deep in this culture that there are people out there who think this is a sequel to Force Awakens. So I think this really separated itself more, and you saw so much more of Jyn, so much more of Cassian Andor and their possible relationship. And then, of course, Donnie Yen, and I forget the other actor's name who's doing it. And then, of course, Saw Gerrera. Got Forrest Whitaker starting the trailer. Perfect tone. And the AT-ACT stuff you were talking about, so great to see that. And the U-Wing, so great to see the U-Wing. That's a new ship. Let's see what that's for. So there was so much here to enjoy, and I'm super excited, not just crazy excited for this thing.
And Kristian?
Terrible. Underwhelming and complete. It's the Last Airbender all over again. No, it's great. I loved it. And I'll tell you that it kind of echoing what Rocha was saying, it did give you that war feel that you wanted when Gareth Edwards pitched it at Star Wars Celebration last year that it's called Star Wars for a reason, and you get that feel. There are a lot of really iconic images already just in this particular, that you guys are talking about, that the rocket launcher into the AT-AT. You're talking about the the TIE fighter at the end, which, by the way, everyone's saying, oh, it's Vader in there. I'm pretty convinced it's one of their pilots that what kind of an idiot just keeps walking towards a TIE fighter? And so she keeps walking towards it. But anyway, that's another discussion. I loved everything that I saw about it. What I really liked is the way, first of all, the music.
Yeah.
I mean, everything about, and then Desplat, I believe, is still doing the music. And if he indeed did the music for that trailer, my God, the way that, very similar to what they do, what Kevin Kiner does in Rebels, it's still letting you know the John Williams classic tones are still going to be there. We're still in the Star Wars universe, and there's little renditions that they put into it to really set the tone of this kind of darker. The Rakuga said it best last night. It felt like the occupation of the Nazis.
Yeah.
It just did all over. Like, and that's what the Empire was always based on. And if you go back into the other stuff with the whether it be Rebels, the animated show, or any of the books, it shows kind of what happened in the lead up to all the planets, and you're getting that in the movies now, and you're going to continue to get that in standalone stories, and this is the one to do it. So I really liked what we saw. I thought it was beautiful looking. I think that and the shot of Vader, obviously, I think it was more fan service than anything else, and it was to let people know that Vader was going to be in it, and it served its purpose. But the standout shots are just that, learning a little bit more about what this team is and what the mission is. They'll probably have to do a little bit more to get some more fans. And there were some people until last night, which I suspected, did not know another Star Wars movie was coming out.
Yeah.
Still, we do. We're in this. We're talking about it all the time. But the casual fan, I think, is starting to learn about it now. So there will be one more trailer, whether or not we want it or not, that explains a little bit more.
Well, I don't think the Darth Vader stuff is a fan service, though. I think it is what Rocha was talking about. Because we're so entrenched in this, we're like, oh, we know everything. We knew Vader was going to show up at the end of this. But a lot of casual fans, one,
well, that's what I mean, though.
Don't know the movie is coming out, and they don't know when it's set. And to them, like, so when they see Darth Vader, they're like, oh, wow, okay, this is where this is going to be set. But I think you're right, though. Even though I personally don't need another trailer, they're going to have to do another one because this is not The Force Awakens. I think The Force Awakens was something everyone knew was coming. They knew it was going to take place. They see Harrison Ford back as Han Solo. They see Mark Hamill back as Luke Skywalker.
Right.
This is totally different. They need to get the casual audiences in the mindset of, okay, this is a prequel that's set before A New Hope. And they know that, like, not everyone knows. That's why they aired it during the Olympics.
Yeah.
There's a reason why they didn't just play this or drop this online. Sinead, you saw this trailer. What did you think?
I mean, I thought it looked awesome. And I think that they definitely do need a new trailer, another trailer, because I haven't heard many people talking about it. And it's crazy to think that the amount of hype leading up to The Force Awakens versus the amount of hype leading up to this, they don't even compare. And like, yeah, we're all excited here, but there isn't a lot of talk about it. So I definitely think putting out another trailer would be a good move, even though we're getting a lot of information in the trailers.
Yeah, I know a lot of people probably in the chat are going crazy. Sinead, lots of people are talking, but we're talking about people that we know.
No, yeah, if you go out and talk to people who aren't diehard movie fans, then you will be surprised to find out that there are not a lot of people talking about this movie.
Yeah, I think it's a great point, because I talked to some of my friends in Virginia and they're just like, wait, is this a sequel? I didn't even know. So this happens. This is a real thing. Mm-hmm. We're caught up in this, and we don't really know 100% how it is out there unless we're talking to people consistently.
Totally.
We're in a big nerd bubble.
We're in a bubble.
Right.
Yeah.
Let's just be excited.
You call it nerds. I call it passionate.
But the thing is interesting, though. I think what Sinead is saying is a good point. Like, you want to have another trailer where I think it goes like 30 years before, or like 30 years before The Force Awakens, or 5 years before, you know, something that lets you have a timeline for the regular fan who's going to be like, okay, where's the set? Okay, when is the set? All right, what is this all about? You know, but I think also one last thing, what you were mentioning, Kristian Makuga, says absolutely right. And it's interesting because they're kind of playing this Nazi thing through Force Awakens.
Well, you did it in the original trilogy.
Right, exactly. You get that vibe. But what are they going after? It seems like they're going after in that planet Jedi. It seems like they're going after something mystical. Like, there's rumors about the origin of the Kyber crystals, all these kinds of things. So what did the Nazis do? The Nazis, when they took over, went right for the artifacts, right for the masterpieces of art. They wanted to control it and have it because there were rumors that they had a belief of this mystical physical evil stuff. So it's all just bleeding into itself, which I think is brilliant.
All right. Well, let's move on to another Star Wars story.
Yes, Han Solo and Chewbacca won't be the only familiar faces when the young Han Solo Star Wars spinoff hits theaters. Per The Wrap, casting is underway for a young Lando Calrissian, the character that was first played by Billy Dee Williams in The Empire Strikes Back. Lando was from Han Solo's past, who offered Han and his buddies refuge, only to double-cross them for Darth Vader. He eventually redeemed himself and was revealed to be a bit of a rogue in the vein of Solo, fighting alongside the good guys in Return of the Jedi. And just as The Wrap dropped the story, a report from Birth Movies Death revealed that Donald Glover is the first choice by Disney and Lucasfilm to take on the role originated by Williams. The report offers very little details for the casting choice, so for now, this should be classified as just a rumor. The character of Lando has popped up here and there in further expansions of the Star Wars franchise, most notably in Star Wars Rebels, that was even voiced by Williams. The actor, be it Donald Glover or another name, will join Alden Ehrenreich in the Phil Lord and Chris Miller helmed anthology, with filming set to begin in January or February of 2017. Christian, who would you like to see play a young Lando Calrissian?
Well, before I say that, yesterday on Jedi Council, I brought up, hey, what if Donald Glover was considered? And I got yelled at by both Perry Nemiroff and John Campy. Like, he's too old! He's never going to be considered. So I actually think he would be good. I think, even though this is probably not the reference that I'd like to go right off the bat, but if you saw Magic Mike 2, I have to see it. Magic Mike 2, he's actually really good in that movie, and he's got like a charming, the movie's terrible, but he's really charming in it, and there's something about him that you could see him doing the Lando-isms, because if you look at someone like Chadwick Boseman, who I think is an amazing actor, one of the best out there right now, a little serious. I don't know if he'd be able to pull off that kind of fun Billy Dee Williams type of charm that Lando had. I think Michael B. Jordan, somebody that could do it. I think Nate Parker is someone that can do it. But I don't know. I think for me right now, after hearing myself say those names, I think Donald Glover would be the best choice out of the three of them. I think they're all talented. I wouldn't complain if any of them got cast, but for me right now, I'd say Donald Glover is my top choice.
Yeah, he's not my top choice. I think he's fine. He does kind of veer more into the comedic realm, at least from what we've seen of him, and that's kind of his background. If they thought Donald Glover was too old, maybe this next pick that I have might be too old as well. Anthony Mackie, you know, do you think he'd nail that charisma and that swagger and kind of that being that scoundrel that, like, deep down, you know, kind of has a good heart, and you know, that's kind of what I'm sure they're going to play the story as. You know, when Han and Lando first meet, they probably hate each other's guts because they're...
No, they're buddies.
Are they?
You know, they have like a rivalry, but it's like a friendly rivalry between smugglers, and then he takes away the Falcon from him. But it's always...
Because a lot of times when people are too similar, they don't like each other when they first meet. That's how I envisioned them meeting. But another name I'd throw out there is Corey Hawkins from Straight Up Compton. I could see him doing it. And he is more on the younger side. Rocha?
Yeah, this is tough for me because Lando's one of my favorite characters, period, in the whole Star Wars universe. And the thing about him, and let's talk truth now, he's got to be sexy. He's got to be smooth. You got to believe that he can hustle these people and sleep with your woman. Like, he is just that
rich. And sell you Colt 45,
right? Yeah. And then sell you a home out from under, and you're kind of like okay with it, even though you're mad. Yeah. That's the thing. And you got to find that right actor that can really encapsulate that charm, and be able to bring it to screen and also have it believable that he could work and do the Empire to the point that he does to get this kind of reputation as a hustler and as a smuggler. So I don't know if we've seen an actor yet, but Donald Glover is a great choice. I think he's funny. He's smooth when he needs to be, and if you listen to his raps, he understands how to play both sides in some of his songs, which is fun to listen to. But I think we got to find that one guy that radiates that kind of smooth sexiness that Billy Dee. It was so effortless the way Billy does it, because that's his essence, and you got to find the right guy. Corey Hawkins could be an interesting choice. We've only seen him in Compton, so we don't know what more he could do.
Walking Dead, you've been
Mackie, by the way, does have the chops. He's like 37.
But I like, I mean, I'm in the camp of Chadwick. I know you're not the biggest believer that that's possible, but I'm in the camp of Chadwick. I think he could do it because he was pimp smooth strong in Civil War with just in those
very
moves.
Serious though.
And in those just moves with Black Widow, he was like, hey, what's up? You know, women went crazy when he came on screen. I heard it in the theater, the audible. Like, he's got that power. So I think he'd be an interesting choice.
All right. What's next?
The Scarlet Speedster has always been a staple character in the DC universe and a key member of the Justice League and literal driving force behind DC's comic book multiverse. The Flash has come into his own on the small screen and has finally been realized on the big screen in Batman v Superman, Dawn of Justice, and Suicide Squad. And despite comments from the higher-ups that say otherwise, many fans were hopeful that the CW's Barry Allen, played by Grant Gustin, would somehow zoom into the DCEU as well. When DC and Warner Brothers chose to cast Ezra Miller as Barry Allen, fans thought that that was the end of the story. Or maybe not. Speaking with MTV News, Ezra Miller spoke about his upcoming standalone Flash movie and revealed that he can't wait to meet up with CW star Gustin, and not just in the real world. Teasing a true multiverse connection, Miller said, "He's a boss. I can't wait to see him, eye to eye, adrift in the Speed Force. Our eyes will lock, and in that moment, we will both know the truth." What truth? I dare not say. DC's head honchos have always remained adamant about keeping the film and television worlds apart, but if there's anyone who could bring the divergent realms together, it's the Scarlet Speedster. We'll have to wait and see when The Flash hits theaters on March 16th, 2018. John, do you think that DC will utilize Speed Force, and will Grant Gustin appear in the DCEU version of The Flash?
Do I want this to happen? Absolutely. I think it'd be great. But it's dangerous because people really wanted Grant Gustin to be the Flash. And if Grant Gustin comes out and completely blows away Ezra Miller on screen, no matter what kind of tricky editing they do, it can really undercut their version and give more fuel to the fire of people who think DC and Warner Brothers, let's do the blame out correctly, are messing this universe up. And I just think that's what the danger is there. I would love to see it because I love Grant Gustin. Obviously, you guys know I cover the Flash Collider show when it was on here on Collider. So I'm a big fan of him as the Flash. I just think it's dangerous. And it kind of speaks to a little bit of the messiness. Now, if they're doing Trudy's Flashpoint, then you've got to go all the way and introduce the other speedsters as well, or at least allude to them. And then if you're going to do that and you can do it effectively, great. But we haven't seen that they've been able to do that effectively yet in any of their movies consistently. And so it worries me, but I just think it's dangerous. That's what I would say.
Kristian?
I think it's dangerous also. I think it'd be interesting. I'd be see how they could pull it off. But you just look at the show and the movies in general, the tones are so different. Mm-hmm. So the question is, how are you going to set that up? Because it was one of the questions when we did Masters of the Web a few years ago, and there was a question that was asked for me of why they were separating the DC cinematic universe from the film universe. I was always on the side where I didn't think that they should do it. Mm-hmm. I thought because Gustin was so beloved by fans already at that point as the Flash that it's going to be hard for Ezra Miller. He's going to get the comparisons, and he already has been. Yeah. And the movie hasn't even come out. I think there will be a lot of people who support Ezra Miller for sure, but I just think it makes it more difficult. You put them in the same movie together, then you, like John is saying, you are opening up for the discussion of who's better, but the thing is, you're having a lot of people talk about it, and you're putting eyes on both products. So it's kind of a win-win if you do it, but it is also dangerous and confusing also. So
I think they're going to do it. They probably won't do it in Justice League. They'll save it for the solo Flash film. I think it's just not going to be that big a deal because it's just going to be him running the Speed Force, and they're just going to see each other, and that's it. It's just going to be a nod to the TV universe. Right. It's going to say, look, that universe exists within ours. It's just an alternate universe. And that's why I don't think there's any concern about showing up Ezra Miller or people getting too tied to Grant Gustin. I think it's just going to be a little bit like he's going to show for like 5 seconds or something like that. And that's it. And I think it's a nice nod to the television fans, but at the same time, it's not going to, you know, confuse any people.
Does it concern you that it's a bit of backtracking too by DC by saying like, we're going to keep them separate, but now that their films are not 100% doing great and they know that their TV shows are revered, they're kind of course correcting and be like, no, maybe we should play around with the idea and see what people think. I wonder if, and then once again, that radiates, if you're backtracking, what do we believe here, you know?
But they have an out though, because they're going to say, oh, it's an alternate universe, you know? And it's like, so everything that happens over here is not going to affect what happens in the movie universe, but we acknowledge that it exists.
Right.
So, all right, now we're on to buy or sell. Sinead, what we got first?
In a strange bit of news coming out of the Fast and Furious 8 production, it was revealed that Dwayne Johnson didn't exactly have the best of time shooting the eighth movie in the franchise. Taken to his Instagram account a couple of days ago, he called out an unnamed candy-ass male co-star as unprofessional. Okay. Rumors quickly swirled as to who exactly Johnson was talking about. Many report it was Vin Diesel. Candy-ass is such a funny-sounding insult. Sorry. And whether this was, it's He's hilarious. Whether it was genuine beef, Johnson has since taken Instagram again to express his thanks to the film's crew and provide a bit of an update. All right, so he said, "You guys reading this know how much I believe in the idea of team effort. That means respecting every person, their time, and their value when they step onto my set or partner with our production company. And like with any team that's a family, there's going to be conflict. Family is going to have differences of opinion and fundamental core beliefs." Johnson went on to stress that conflict isn't always a bad thing, and the whole Fast and Furious 8 team is focused on one simple goal. "To me, conflict can be a good thing when it's followed by great resolution. I was raised on healthy conflict and welcome it. And like any family, we get better from it. At the end of the day, me and the F8 co-stars all agree on the most important thing, delivering an incredible movie to the world. #Fast8, #IcemanCometh, #FamilyGrowth. Whatever the case may be, this might not be the last of this, and the Fast and Furious 8 press tour should be mighty interesting. Directed by F. Gary Gray, Fast 8 opens in theaters on April 14th, 2017. Dennis, you buy or sell the beef with The Rock is actually over?
I sell this. I think there's going to be more beef coming. I think they're just going to temper it for now. It comes out when? In April of next year? A few months before, like, Vin Diesel will probably, like, say something on social media that will, like, be, like, a kind of a veiled, like, dig at The Rock. And then The Rock will say something, and they'll escalate their beef as the movie is about to come out, and then at the red carpet premiere they're gonna make up and be friends again. That's what I think. Christian?
I'm gonna buy it because I think Vin Diesel at this point knows that he's gotta back off, because I think what Vin Diesel, if you, and I talked about this last night, if you look, Vin Diesel, to his credit, was the guy that really, for a celebrity, booked jobs through social media, teased roles through social media, really became the actor who mastered social media to help further his brand. And now there's The Rock, who did that times 50. And The Rock, if you look at it, like, back in the day when, like, Stallone and Schwarzenegger just did not get along because they were the competing guys. They both have egos, but Rock has a little bit more to stand on right now. He's more likable. He has more franchises that work for him. For everything, people, there's more stories about people liking to work with him, and more stories about people saying that Vin Diesel has been difficult in times, whether he's been late on set and all those type of things. So if you're Vin Diesel at this point, you probably had a conversation with your people or whatever it was. Let's squash this. Rock, please go out and say something nice. The Rock does it. He's a smart politician, also knows how to do these things. And you just bury it, because The Rock is a guy that did this for a living, smack talking for a living, on the road every day for a living. He can crush Vin Diesel with his following. He can. So if Vin Diesel was smart at this point, he backs off. He doesn't worry about it. I think it's just gonna squash. Rock said it's done. Mm-hmm. If I'm Diesel, I'm already said it's done, I'm done. And I might show up on set and do a little breakdance for everybody.
Rocha.
It's interesting. I buy it, but tentatively, because, yeah, the more I look at it, the more I'm kind of in your camp a little bit, Dennis, that I think it might be a bit fabricated for the publicity of it. But I don't know, because why does this film need any more publicity than it's already going to have? Like, what is this going to get, an extra $2 million? Like, it doesn't make any sense to me. I would see if it was coming back, then maybe, because we want to get people excited to see what the beef is. But this to me seems like two egos crashing into each other. And The Rock, you know, when he first started out doing that Scorpion King stuff, he was very humble, very understanding of the situation. But he wasn't the greatest actor, but he worked at it. He got these opportunities. He fell back down and then came back up. But, and then now he's doing so much. He's like the hardest working man in showbiz. Literally, he has an app that wakes you up and works out with you. He has the TV show Ballers. He's doing this. He's producing reality shows.
So like, he launched his YouTube channel.
I have friends
that work over there. Yeah, and just launched it.
Well, put in a good word. I like a job. I love The Rock. He's like the Black Ryan Seacrest. Like, the man does not stop. When does he sleep? I don't know. But he's amazing in this. And I think this is where Vin is maybe having a bit of a slam into, because this is Vin's property. Right. And so The Rock was probably pushing for more screen time, more storyline that benefited him, and Vin was pushing back, and that's going to happen. Two egos are going to slam into themselves.
Do you think this is going to bleed over into the premiere? It doesn't matter what you think!
Rudy Poo Candy Ass! guys.
Yeah. You mentioned ballers, and just to add fuel to the fire, there in a recent episode, he has a dig at Vin Diesel.
Yes,
like someone mistakes him for Vin Diesel, and he goes, "Oh no, I'm bigger and better looking."
Right. Yeah.
And so, you know, I don't know. It's one of those things. Is this planted? Is this? Are they like, you know, fabricating this
for
this?
The movie?
Yeah.
Yeah, but the thing is, they're buddies in the movie now. That's the thing.
Are they?
Yeah. I mean, they were in the last two. Maybe they have beef again. I don't know. Then it starts to turn into a real wrestling story. Yeah.
But this is his growing power, though, that he can do this. Right?
Is this something
The Rock can do this?
The question is,
he would have never done that to him.
Is there a chance? Let's just say, because The Rock knows how to sell things.
He really does.
And Vince McMahon and him are tight. And WrestleMania comes out about a week after, I think, whatever it is, the
Fast Eight.
Is there a chance that Vin Diesel versus The Rock happens at WrestleMania?
That'd be awesome.
You never know. Don't put it past Vince McMahon.
No. All right, what's next?
While filming on Spider-Man Homecoming has been underway for nearly a month already, casting for the Marvel and Sony Pictures co-production is continuing to take place. Per Deadline, Orange is the New Black actor Michael Chernus has been added to the ensemble in the villainous role of the Tinkerer. This was actually a part many reported on back in May via Joe Blow, and now Deadline confirms that it is the Tinkerer who will be in the Spider-Man pick, with Chernus bringing the character to life. Michael Keaton reportedly plays the film's main villain, rumored to be Vulture, and as we learned at Comic-Con, Vulture's suit is entirely tech-based. This fits into the Marvel Cinematic Universe, which itself is very tech-centric, as opposed to more the mystical or organic, but Vulture needs some help in putting his flying suit together. That's where the character of the Tinkerer comes in, and that's likely where his involvement in the picture ends. If the role could be cast in the middle of production, it's likely not a huge part for the movie. Chernus joins Tom Holland, Marissa Tomei, Robert Downey Jr., Donald Glover, and Zendaya in the movie directed by cop car helmer John Watts. Spider-Man Homecoming hits theaters on July 7th, 2017. Rocha, do you buy or sell the addition of the Tinkerer in Spider-Man Homecoming?
Yeah, I buy it. I think it's a good addition. Michael Chernus is an interesting choice because the Tinkerer is always an older guy. You know, he looks a little bit like a weird brother, Patrick Stewart. So it would be interesting. It's interesting they've gone with a way younger guy, which speaks to me that they are really doing this thing like an origin story. It reaffirms that they're doing the origin story here with Spider-Man. Because the Tinkerer, if you look at the history of comics with him, he's connected to Mysterio, he's connected to Scorpion, he's connected to S.H.I.E.L.D. He's got all this stuff going. There's so many Hobgoblin, Wolverine, Venom, Doctor Doom, including Captain Marvel. So there's so much, and Kraven the Hunter, which is my favorite Spider-Man villain that never gonna freaking do. So he's got so many connections to not just the Spider-Man universe, but outside the Spider-Man universe. So if they make him some kind of central figure that people can go to because he's a technical expert, he creates these outfits that they wear, you know, this technology stuff, all the stuff that he's tied into, I think it's certainly possible to have him get involved in this universe and help it promote the idea that he's kind of like this quiet character that people can go to, kind of like the collector you have now with Benicio del Toro. So I think it's a nice addition. It's interesting they've gone younger, and we'll see what happens.
Yeah, I buy it as well, as long as they do use him in that role and not as like a main villain. We don't need to see another, you know, we already had that problem with the last Amazing Spider-Man. We had that problem with Spider-Man 3, where there were just so many villains. As long as they have him in the role that you're talking about, where he's just helping out. I mean, he helped create Mysterio's suit. He helped create Scorpion's tail.
Yeah.
So in this case, if he helps Vulture build his
and
suit,
he does
it makes sense, right?
Yeah.
And Vulture, like I said, it wasn't someone I was that interested in, but if Michael Keaton is going to play that character, then I'm far more interested. Not only is he not older, he's not, like, at least from the comic book images I saw, Michael Chernus is like a bigger guy.
Yeah.
The Tinker in the comic book, he's like the small, frail old man. So, it's definitely a departure. Christian?
Yeah, it's cool that they're going to tinker with it. He's really good in Orange is the New Black. As the brother, he's got it. There's an air to humor to him, but I think that if you're going to put him with someone like Michael Keaton, he's not going to be his role. The one thing is, it's not an origin story, though, Spider-Man. It's not an origin.
He's in high school.
That's not origin, though. Yeah. Origin is how he becomes Spider-Man.
Fair.
It's definitely a younger Spider-Man in like the earlier days of him being Spider-Man. But, you know, you have this character. And the one thing that people are going to get scared of, there's too many characters in this. This is just news of other. It's not like a big, huge name. Yeah, it's just someone who's going to serve the plot. I'm okay with it. It's not going to be a huge role. It's just going to be someone, like you guys are saying, is going to help Vulture. Maybe down the line helps other villains. Great.
Yeah.
All right, what's next?
Bad Boys 3 is forging ahead, and no one is more excited than Josh McCuga, who threw a parade in downtown LA when the news first was announced. However, Sony Pictures is now making a couple of changes as the project inches closer towards production. The studio announced an ambitious slate of release dates last summer, with Bad Boys 3 put on the schedule for release in February 2017. It was quickly moved to June 2nd, where it would be going head-to-head with Wonder Woman. And now that date is off the table as well. The sequel, which will see Will Smith and Martin Lawrence reprising their roles, has now been pushed to January 12th, 2018, and has been given a new title, Bad Boys for Life. The Grey and A-Team filmmaker Joe Carnahan will write and direct the project that is now going head-to-head with Fox's Maze Runner, The Death Cure. Sony also announced a release date for Bad Boys 4 for July 3rd, 2019, but we haven't heard any more about a further sequel just yet. Christian, do you buy or sell the new release date for Bad Boys for Life in January?
For Life. I'm gonna sell it. It's bizarre. I think that I understand the moves that they say, well, we're definitely not going to go up against Wonder Woman, so let's stick it in January and hope, because there's nothing else in January. It's usually the toilet bowl of the season, and it's just going to be a bunch of crappy horror movies there. Let's try to go up in the first 2 weeks when everybody starts watching movies again. Let's give it a shot, which could pay off, but if you're then your sequel's going to come out in the summertime, years later, I don't know. It's weird. I think it's a little... First of all, I think they're going... They should not announce a sequel to this movie. We don't know. Right? We don't know if the Bad Boys 3 is still going to have the audience that it had besides Josh McCuga buying most of the tickets. We haven't seen Martin Lawrence in God knows how long. Is the chemistry still there? You know, Will Smith has it. I mean, I'm not doubting Will Smith anymore, because when I thought Will Smith was going to be too big of a movie star to play Deadshot, I was dead wrong. He's the best part of the whole entire movie. Mm-hmm. Will Smith certainly still has it, and Will Smith can carry the movie, and it can be a lot of fun. And I actually love the idea that Joe Carnahan is directing this movie, because that's a different movie than the Michael Bay movies that we got in the past. So I don't know what it's going to look like. I just think January is strange. If they would have stuck to February, I think I would have bought it, but I'm going to sell it because January scares me.
Yeah. Rocha.
Yeah, this is interesting because January, you're right. What you say, Christian, is like the toilet bowl of release dates. So you haven't even started shooting yet and you're already putting it there. Like, that tells you how much faith you have in the project. And it should change the title from Bad Boys to Old Men. It's just ridiculous. I mean, it's these guys. Martin Lawrence is 51. Will Smith is 47. I mean, I'm 40. I can't be doing the stuff they're doing. So it's just crazy to me that they're going to go. This is like kind of akin to what happened with Lethal Weapon. Like, once they crossed, 3 was really pushing the line. 4 was ridiculous. And so you're just like, okay, this, we're done here. Like, let's just move on. So I worry that they're already greenlighting a sequel to this, you know, fourth movie, without even seeing what the returns are going to be like, how Martin's going to be. So do I buy or sell the release date? I sell it because I think it's a bad idea, but I don't know why we're taking so long to make this movie. Carnahan's a great choice because you're right, Christian. It'll make it a little darker, maybe a little more grittier, independent, a little less of the flamboyant car chases that McCuga loves so much. So he may not be excited to see this movie now, but it's going to be definitely a little, it might be a nice departure from form that'll help save the franchise, possibly.
Yeah, I'm going to sell it. I'm going to sell the name Bad Boys for Life. It's basically from Puff Daddy's song.
I was going to say, yeah.
It's a Puff Daddy lyric.
From the 90s, from the early 2000s. Yeah.
And I'm going to sell the release date. I mean, I can't believe that this will be the actual date. I feel like they're going to move it. Will sit out and just, it bombs and sucks, and there's no audience for it. It's just one of those things where I don't know if this generation of moviegoers is really, you know, other than Josh McCuga, is very interested in seeing another movie.
I mean, who's clamoring for Martin Lawrence to come back and do a film? That's the thing, that audience is kind of set sail, it's not like the reruns of that Martin show where, like, people are like, oh, this is the greatest thing ever, you know? That's the sad, and what's Taya Leone doing? Bring her back, too, if you're going to bring the old gang back together. The second one wasn't that great, and they kind of pushed the boundaries, making them all take on Cuba just themselves, which was ridiculous. So you're just like, well, what are we going to do? Are we going to go back to a smaller story, which that'd be great, but if they go to even bigger lengths where they're making them international stuff, then I'm just like, oh man, what are we doing?
All right, let's check in with Wendy and see what the chat room is talking about in terms of the Rogue One trailer and the Rock Vin Diesel beef.
Well, obviously, we're all psyched to see the trailer for Rogue One. It was beautiful, it was epic, but a couple of comments I saw saying that the shot of Vader was lame because, I don't know if it was short or something. Uter74 says, I don't want any more trailers for Rogue One. I am sold already, and so are most people, so don't ruin this. Time for some calibrations. It says, great trailer, but Vader needs a Chewie, we're home moment, and what he got wasn't that. And moving on to our buy or sell segment, talking about The Rock. So the chat smells what The Rock is cooking, and it smells like a publicity stunt, and that's a sell for our live viewers. They're saying that this conflict should have been kept behind closed doors, and that's where they belong. Ita Corez says, is The Rock suddenly becoming a 15-year-old that's complaining about mean people? When did adult actors start using Instagram? Looks like kids. Embarrassing. And Gerald says, them hashtags.
All right, thank you, Wendy. Now we're on to our box office prediction segment brought to you by our friends at AMC Theaters. This is where we try and predict the top five grossing movies of this weekend. Christian, do you have your top five?
I do indeed. Okay, let's see. So coming in at number one, I got Suicide Squad for a second week. I think the family's going to take their vacation and go see Pete's Tracking Dog. And then Sausage Party at number three, Jason Bourne at four, and then Bad Moms at five, and Meryl Streep will be knocking at the door at six.
Okay, my list is actually pretty similar to yours, except for I actually have Pete's Dragon over Suicide
Squad. Really?
Yeah, I just feel like even though I thought the movie was okay, I think it caters to, it's got the name behind it. It's like, you know, based on the classic animated film. And Disney's been killing it on their, you know, the way they've been marketing movies, and they're just getting people to come in.
How much of a drop-off do you think Suicide Squad's going to have?
Probably like 60%.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you think Pete's Dragon's going to make that much?
I mean, you never count out kids and parents.
No,
going
I don't
to
think it's a crazy
movies.
Choice.
Yeah.
I
have Pete's Dragon number one, Suicide Squad number two, Sausage Party three, four Jason Bourne, and five Bad Moms. Rocha?
Yeah, my list is exactly the same as Christian. Suicide Squad, Pete's Dragon, Sausage Party, Jason Bourne, and Bad Moms. Suicide Squad is tracking better than people thought, and it, you know, there were rumors that it might, because it dropped on Saturday and Sunday, but on Monday and Tuesday it actually went back up. So there is a rewatchability factor going on there, that people are going back to support it. The diehard DC fans and maybe people who want to see it a second time to see if they really liked it or hated it. I just think the problem with Pete's Dragon is there hasn't been the level of visibility that there was with Jungle Book. Like, there doesn't seem to be that kind of promotion behind it and pushing behind it. And so I think if it had more of mainstream knowledge of it, I think it would beat Suicide Squad. But at this point, with Secret Life of Pets still in the theaters, there's excuses to go to other movies besides Pete's Dragon. So I don't think it's enough to put it to number one.
I think you make a good point, though, about Suicide Squad. Because I said this in our review, because I enjoyed Suicide Squad. I believe Batman v Superman is a better made film than Suicide Squad. Mm-hmm. But Suicide Squad, because it's more fun, people are more inclined to go see it again.
And it's shorter.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. They don't have to wait, you know, 2.5 hours for the end battle sequel.
Do you think they'll figure out that the Suicide Squad created the problem that the Suicide Squad had to fix? Do you think they'll figure that out as they watch the movie again? I'm just asking.
Opening
all
up
right,
the door.
All right, guys. Before we move on to mailbag, we got a couple of things we want to talk about. One, there's some sort of mystery special video coming to our Best of the Week show on Saturday at 2 p.m. that Perry Nemiroff hosts.
It's just like images. That's all we're getting.
Yeah, yeah. What are these images that we have? We don't have these images. Wow. Okay. There we go.
What is that? Oh, yeah, on the back screen.
Yeah, we have it on the back screen there. So there is some strange person with a fuzzy hat, and there's Darth Vader there.
That's more that we saw him in the Rogue One trailer.
Yeah. So stay tuned for Saturday, 2 p.m. Check out Best of the Week for this special video. Also, going up today is the highly anticipated rematch between Scott Mance and John Rocha for the movie Trivia Schmodown. There you see this decider in Collider. Let's go to Christian. Yeah. Why is everyone anticipating this match so much?
It's so funny. I came in today and Dennis goes, I've never seen so many comments that are looking forward to this rematch. The title match between Riley and Merle was really anticipated, but not like this. Everyone wants to see these two animals go at it. They are just, yes, are they friends outside of this thing? Sure. But when it comes to this trivia, you have to separate them. And there's a lot at stake, but I'll let the man hear the outlaw. Yesterday, you had Mance kind of coming after John Choka. There was a hashtag John Choka. And so now the outlaw, John Rocha, I know you want to go bananas. Please don't slam the table too much. What do you got?
No, there'll be no slamming. There'll be no anger. John Choka, that's exactly what a person at senior assisted living would come up with. So I'm not surprised that that's the best he could do. He was always lame at this game. I was always better at him at this game. He backed into a win last time. This time I'm coming more focused, more determined. I took him lightly last time. I thought I had him, and then I blew it on Star Wars. And for 4 months, I've eaten so much bleep from so many fans, from so many people, even people here, even my so-called friends here at Collider have given me so much crap about Bespin. Just because I couldn't come up with that thing because Cloud City kept coming into my head. Well, now, Mance, it's you and me again on the Schmodown for a shot at the ultimate Schmodown. And that's where I belong. Where the outlaw belongs is the ultimate Schmodown because I am the ultimate competitor. And I want that belt around my waist. And this time, no handshakes, no hugs, no lovey-dovey crap between friends. This is a competition, and I want your ass. And I want it now.
Oh, that's going on a meme.
I'm just telling you now. And I'm coming for you hardcore. And I know you had this. You and that joke, Jason Inman. You had Shatner here. Well, I got Shatner for you. Yeah? You know what? You know what I'm going to do to you? You know what I'm doing to you today? That's what I'm doing to you today. I'm taking the head off the snake.
Ripped off William Shatner's head.
That's it, Kirk. You're going down. You're dying. There'll be nothing left of you. This is like this. Live long and prosper. That's what I'm telling you, Mance. You need to live long and prosper. And Inman, no. When I'm done with Mance.
I have to Inman now.
Inman. Hey, geek history. Hey. I'm smacking on a big forehead of yours. Hey, geek history. I'm going to come for you next, and I'm going to teach you a little lesson. We're going to have a special episode of Geek History Lesson. It's going to be called Geek History Whoopin', and I'm going to beat that ass. Do you understand me? I'm going to take Mance's ass, and then I'm going to beat
right
Inman's
next to
ass.
It. All right.
Are we okay?
It's like all Vin right. Diesel and The Rock.
Listen,
all over
I'm
again.
Just saying, hashtag candy asses. I want some candy asses.
You want a lot of ass, it sounds
yeah,
like.
Yeah. Rocha seems very fascinated with the asses. Everyone's asses.
Ooh, what happened to that?
Right. Well, that goes up. That's today, 2 p.m. I definitely wouldn't miss this one.
All right, now moving on to mailbag. A reminder, you can email us at collidervideo@gmail.com, and we can answer your questions either on our daily movie talk show like today or on our weekend mailbag show on Saturday and Sunday. Sinead, what do we got?
First of all, that was the dirtiest threat I've ever heard in my life. All right, Kevin Tzeng writes, "Hi, Collider Movie Crew. I watch your movie talk show every day as it's part of my daily routine. My question is something that has come up due to the critics and DC Comics relationship recently. Why can't there be critics on movie sets to judge the film? Or maybe when the script is being made or edited? Critics in the movie making would help movies be successful by finding mistakes. I'm not saying that critics should be on all movie sets. I'm just saying, shouldn't they have more of an active role in filmmaking? Thanks, and keep up the awesome work."
The short answer to that is hell no. for two reasons. One, egos, you have the studios are already battling with the producers and the director on the directions of the movies. So you have that, you know, if you stick a critic in there, that's just going to, you know, if the studio goes, oh, well, the critic guy liked this about what my suggestions or the director, no, the critic guy likes this. It's just another problem in terms of the workflow. And then the other main reason why it can't happen is it's, I don't think it would help at all, because the reason why critics can talk about movies is because the movies are done. They go watch them. Everything's completed. In the process of making a movie, and we mentioned this before, is it's not like filmmakers set out to make a crappy movie. Everyone's trying their best. Even the worst filmmakers are trying their best to make a good movie, at least for the most part. And a lot of times, during that process, in the writing process, the filming process, the editing process, you don't know what you have. So if a critic's there like, oh, well, I don't know about this, you should change this or that, it's not something so easily done. Critics can to make those criticisms and those analysis that are actually, I find some of them to be spot on, but it's after the movie came out, after you see the completed product project, which is a whole lot easier. Christian?
Well, that's the thing, is that they're full film critics. Yeah. They're watching the full film. They're not creative executives. Yeah. That's the job of a producer. That's the job of a creative executive. It's not the job of a critic. Critic goes, well, it could be interesting if this actually turns it. Shut up and go do your review. So when the movie is out, when the movie is, that's what the critic should be doing. That's what I wouldn't want to go in there as a critic and start saying, well, that would be interesting. I don't know what the finished product is. I don't know what the director's vision is, ultimately what it's going to look like on the screen. Now, that's not to say that some of the, maybe there's a particular critic that you like, that the way that they analyze film, that you say, well, that person might actually be a good creative executive, or might be a good production. That's up to that particular critic. If they want that new job, then that's something that they should explore. But no, critics should never be on set reviewing or getting involved in movies. It's not their job. It's not their place.
Rocha?
Yeah, it's so weird to me, this whole idea of having a critic on set. I mean, because there are enough voices on any set that you go and do a movie on, with executives, with ADs, with the DP, with the writers that sometimes are on set, all those kinds of things that are going on. If you throw in a critic, it is just going to grind movies even more to a halt. And they'll be questioning every daily. They'll be questioning a performance. Do you want a critic? Do you think a critic, when you go up to him, and an actor goes up to him in the break area and Crafty is like, hey, how do you think my performance is going? You know what? It could be a situation where he could be undercutting what the director's trying to do. So, you know, there's all kinds of things that could happen. And if you pick a critic to come on set, then a lot of people accuse that critic of playing favorites, of being unable to objectively analyze the film, right, even if he had input in how him or her had input in how the film was made. You know, it'll be an issue that comes up. So to me, I think it would just drag everything to a halt, grind everything to a halt, and production-wise, it would just be a waste of time, and people would lose jobs eventually because they're taking too long to do these films, and if they don't come out perfectly, then what's the point?
And to my point earlier, there's a show I mentioned sometimes, Dinner for Five, that Favreau does.
Great show.
He did this one episode that Michael Rapaport was on. I forgot the other people. I think like Faison and Sarah Silverman. They talked about movie making, and they talked about how, even as the director and being on set, they don't know. They likened it to like a basketball on the rim. Mm-hmm. They don't know where the ball is the basketball going to fall in, exactly, or is going to fall out. And they're doing. They don't know until the very, once they see the final product. And it's just one of those things where a critic just can't help with that. They're not part of that process.
And so many happy accidents happen on set while you're filming that you discover your movie. And you discover your movie in the editing process. Yeah. People don't understand how essential editing is to a movie.
You can make or break someone's performance with editing. You can make someone look like a terrible actor, or you can make them look like a fantastic actor. Yeah. And you could, in just by seconds, you can hold on someone's performance for like a few seconds longer, and you would maybe start laughing and say, oh, that's terrible. Or you cut at the right time and they look fantastic.
Yeah.
All right, guys, now on to live Twitter questions. You can tweet us at Collider Video. Sinead, we'll pick out a few. What do we got first?
Angus tweets, what's the hardest you've laughed at a movie in the theater?
Steve Carell in the movie itself was okay, but Bruce Almighty, Jim Carrey starts, you know, having the power over him, he's like, doing all that stuff. I was not expecting it, and Steve Carell was basically unknown, and I just lost it. I was like, tears coming out of that, and then Team America with the puppet sex. That killed me.
God, I love that movie. Yeah.
Team America?
Love that movie.
Matt Damon. Similar to Christian, not the best movie, but certainly one I enjoy, The Heat. There's a line where Melissa McCarthy says to the actor playing the albino, she says, you don't look so good. You look a little pale. Are you all right? And I lost it. I mean, it's an albino joke. It's low-hanging fruit. I get it. But I lost it. I ran from one side of the theater to the other because I had to get away from everyone else. I was laughing so hard. I was crying. Like, for 10 minutes, I was crying. And every time it comes on TV and I happen to catch that moment, I lose my cry every time because it's just brilliant. You look a little pale.
See, for me, my answer will show you how strange I am. It's not a comedy. The most I ever laughed was me, Roth, and this other girl went to go see this movie, August Rush. Do you know that movie?
With Carrie Russell.
Carrie Russell. Right. And
good soundtrack. John Legend does a soundtrack on that, yeah.
And the whole time watching it, because we were around there, and all these people are really into it. So when people are really into a movie, you're holding everything back, and there's so many ridiculous things in that movie. One of which being, so it's about this what this little kid that like is musically
talented.
He's like
a talented. Musical prodigy, yeah. Right?
So he's like, how old is he? Like, I don't know, 10 years old. And they're like, oh, and they cut to him playing the guitar. These giant man hands, yeah. You know what I mean? Adult hands are just like playing. It's like, am I supposed to believe that this kid is playing? There's just so many, and Robin Williams, look, I love Robin Williams, yeah. But he was dressed up as Bono. He like, mm-hmm. If you see it, there were so many ridiculous things. And at the very end, it had what's the guy's name? Like Jonathan Rhys-Meyers. Uh-huh.
Oh, yeah.
Like him and Carrie Russell get together at this thing with the kid.
It's just a ridiculously bad movie.
Yeah.
I would say Under Siege 2 is one of those, too.
But we were holding it in so much that at the very end, we just started dying. Like, tears were coming. But, like, all these people around were, like, they were, like, so happy and clapping and everything. And we just waited till they got out of the theater, and we're just dying. Right. So that's the most I've ever laughed at a movie theater. Sinead, how about you? What's the most you ever laughed?
Mine is Mamma Mia. And it was
watching Pierce Brosnan sing.
The very first second he opened his mouth to sing, the entire theater erupted in like laughter and cheering. People were standing up and clapping because it was so awful that the entire movie became such a joke. And I was laughing more because everyone else was laughing too. And people were like screaming things at the screen. Oh, yeah. And he was just like the worst singer ever. It was great.
All right, let's do two more.
Awesome. All right. A. Clay writes, could you see any of the Guardians of the Galaxy get a standalone movie?
Christian?
Standalone movie? No. I don't think they're going to get a... I mean, no. I think that the novelty is the fact that they're all together. It's this team. They've marketed this team together. I don't know if I'd want to see a standalone movie with any of them. And I would like to see, you know, like if Star-Lord popped up in one of the other movies down the line, or if there were Guardians that popped up in other movies, sure, but I don't want to see standalone movies from the Guardians.
I would agree with you. I don't think a standalone movie. I think the closest you'd come is Groot and Rocket Raccoon movie. That would be awesome. I'd love to see that. Those guys have such great... I mean, they're the heart of the movie. And you would love to see something like that where they explore his origins, like go back and try to find out how he became what he became. Becomes this adventure, you know, there's a villain involved and what have you, kind of a la Wolverine type thing. And you have Groot being the guy that's there to, like, he talks to when he breaks down. So that's the closest I would say.
Yeah, I'm with you. I think the only... one I'd want to see is a spinoff with Groot and Rocket Raccoon. I don't know if I'd want to see the origin story. I just want to see them on some sort of adventure, kind of maybe even pre-Guardians of the Galaxy, where they go off and have some sort of mission or I don't know, some bounty or whatever. Because, you know, that's kind of what they were doing already and how they met up with Star-Lord. All right, let's do one more.
Brad tweets, are there any panel members with tattoos, and what movie or movie characters would you choose to get inked? For me, it would be Batman.
I have no tattoos.
Ellis made this whole big thing that he just got a brand new one. He's
a tramp stamp? A tramp stamp?
Who knows? He said he got one. He's going to debut it on the Schmo Show, but I would assume it's either Van Halen or something else. I think Makuga might, Riley might have Superman, I think. I don't know. I definitely don't. If I was going to get anything, in the movie related world, it'd probably be something. Probably the
you get Arnold on your ass.
Yeah. What's with you and asses today?
Today.
I mean, seriously.
Am I allowed to say that word?
You can say it. You just seem obsessed with it.
Good Lord.
He wants the ass and he wants it now.
Wow. Do you guys realize that they can take sections of this and do whatever they want with it? There could be a song now of you saying that. I can assure you that someone right now...
Can there be a rap?
Yeah, so let's go.
Rocha?
Mance is going to have a tattoo of me on his ass.
There we go.
There it is. No. I don't have any tattoos. I mean, as an actor, you're kind of discouraged to have any. So for a long time, I didn't. I would love to have sleeves of tattoos. I think that's certainly my future if I ever finally give up thinking I can be on screen acting or something. But if I did put an actor, that's really difficult. I think more a character. Maybe, you know, I think it'd be awesome to have the Punisher as a tattoo, the skull, or even D.D. as Daredevil. He's one of my favorite superheroes and things of that nature. But I don't think there's anyone I would necessarily, in terms of an actor, tattoo myself with. You know?
Yeah, I don't have any, and if I had to do one, I don't think it'd be anything like a character from a movie. Maybe it'd be more filmmaking related, like something like a camera. But then at that point, then it ends up being kind of pretentious. You know what I mean?
A camera.
Sinead?
I have one tattoo on my forearm.
What is that?
What's it
say?
Someone asked me if it was a chicken nugget at the bar. It's not. It's Africa.
Oh, yeah. I heard someone else thought it was something else.
A dolphin. And I got a gun. Someone was like, where in Brazil are you from? But it's Africa. I've thought about getting the Superman S before just because my name starts with an S. And that's pretty much the only one I think I would ever get. And if I did, I would like change all the colors because I think that getting like things like brands that are super popular is kind of lame. But ideally, I plan to get so many more tattoos.
Wow.
All right, guys, that's it for this episode of Movie Talk. I want to thank the people joining us. Wendy, where can people find you?
You can find me on Twitter, Instagram, and Snapchat at Wendy Lee Zaney.
And John Rocha, when you're not on the streets looking for ass, where can people find you?
You guys, you can always find me at The Rocha Says on Twitter and on Instagram. See all the shows I co-host on all the shows I host. And you can also listen to The Cinephiles, which is the new podcast I'm doing on iTunes, where we break down one classic movie before the year 2000. And of course, every Wednesday at 2 p.m. here for the Top 10 show. We just did Top 10 live-action Disney films, which was a really great fun episode that Matt and I had. And one last thing. Natasha Martinez, you sold out your race. You took on the manse. And I'm coming for you next time. And DC All Access, that's going to be standing for Dead Caucasian All Access when I'm done with you, Inman. And then one last thing. Scott Mance, I love you to death. I will absolutely sign the form to commit you to the senior assisted living when I'm done with you here. And then we will never have a match again. I'm going to put you in there for infinity.
All right, well, thank you, Seymour Butts. You can find me at Kristian Harloff on Twitter and Instagram, and then apparently the tattooed lady, El Diablo over here, will give you the rest of her sign-off stuff.
All right, I'm online at Sinead DeVries and at thatsosinead.com. On Mondays, hosting TV Talk. On Fridays, hosting Movie Talk. Mailbag over the weekends. You guys do not want to miss Best of the Week tomorrow at 2. You have to take it from me. Trust me. Make sure you tune in because it's literally worth it. The video is amazing. So 2 p.m. tomorrow, Best of the Week.
And you guys can find me on Twitter at ThinkHero, on Instagram, Dennis.TZNG. You also find me on Movie Talk Mondays and Fridays, and then on Saturday, Mailbags. Don't forget to subscribe to this YouTube channel, youtube.com/collidervideos, and we'll see you guys next time.
Hey guys, if you like this video, click the thumbs up button. Also, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. It'll help you stay up to date with everything we've got going on here at Collider.